calling.
Wow, how many people are we?
Approximately 8, I guess.
Wow, thank you guys for coming. I'm in my living room in your classroom. This is strange.
Welcome to Ukraine, welcome to Kiev. Welcome to our International Shevchenko National University. We are very glad to have you today.
Woo!
And I will be a moderator of this Q&A session for today. First of all, let me congratulate you with a great third season finale of Suits. That was awesome. Yeah? That was great. So today we're going to have a good old Q&A session. I have some questions. You maybe have some answers for them.
Great.
Alright, so let's begin. I guess we will be talking about Suits today. You can see me, I'm here. Right here. Yeah. Alright, so the first question will be about Mike Ross, about his personality. Could you tell us what are the similarities and differences between you and Mike Ross' character?
That's a great question. When I first read it, I've seen a lot of television, obviously, and I've never really been too attracted to legal shows because I think a lot of time when people portray lawyers on television or in film, it's so much about the manipulation and it's so much about the strategy, which I think can be really, really interesting. But I think for me, the inroad to this story was that you had a character who really did believe in justice. He believed that there were people that went through life having things happen to them that truly were not fair, and there was no one to fight for them. And so that social justice angle to Mike Ross, that thing that, you know, he's lost his family to this terrible disaster, he doesn't really have anybody in the world, he's used to seeing people and being one of those people that gets taken advantage of. And for me, I feel very strongly in my life that I've had that since I was a kid. I feel I've always, since I was very little, seen someone getting bullied at school or, getting bullied after school, or people that I knew that were having situations that weren't fair. I would usually step in and do whatever I could to help. And so I was really attracted to the idea of playing a character that, you know, could have fun and mess around and put on these nice clothes and, you know, make fun of Harvey Specter. But at the same time, when he was doing that, go and help people out and do something good with his life. And it was interesting to me to have a character who believed in good things try and operate in a corporate law world, which is typically got a lot of less than moral things going on in it sometimes, especially in sort of the American corporate landscape. And I thought it was really interesting to take someone who had a clear, you know, sharp moral compass and put him in the middle of a lot of people who aren't used to having that kind of person around.
You speak so good legal English. Did you have any additional legal training for that role?
Not other than arguing with my parents for 18 years.
Okay, can you hear people laughing because we have a mic? Yeah, you can hear that. Okay,
I can hear, yeah.
Because they're laughing all the time. Great excited the chemistry between you and Harvey Specter, yeah, played by Gabriel Knox. And it is considered as the greatest, as the key to success of the show. What is the magic behind these relations and how you get along on the Suits production?
We cannot stand each other. We don't say a word to each other. You heard it here. No, that's a lie. Gabriel has been, he's kind of like, he's been a big brother to me. You know, he's been working a lot longer than I have, and he's had a lot more experience. And so this being sort of my first really big, all-encompassing, everyday job, seven-month thing that I do every year, I've looked up to him for a lot of it. And, you know, really our relationship began, we usually for these types of shows, they'll do sort of a chemistry test and they'll get two actors in a room and they'll sort of read them together and make sure that they get along before you embark on years and years of trying to make a television show. But for this show, for some reason, they didn't. They just cast me. I was cast first, and then I know they were looking for Gabriel, and then they cast him. And then we basically found out we had been cast, and I said, do you want to go get do you want to go get lunch together? And so we show up at this lunch and we sit down across from each other, and I'll let you in on a little secret, but I think, you know, actors can be really terrible people sometimes. And we were scared when we went to go sit at lunch that we were, but we had signed on to something where this other person was just, you know, going to be somebody who we suddenly really didn't want to work with, really, you know, egomaniac or, you know, just not interested in doing the work. So we both sort of sat down at this dinner and just at this lunch and just stared at each other kind of for a minute. Sort of, I started asking sort of random questions just to get a sense of who they were. And then within 10 minutes, we realized that we were totally on the same page, that, you know, we were both really dedicated to doing the work, to not bringing any ego to the table, to supporting each other in the process. He really taught me a lot about you know, respecting somebody else's process and learning how to take that sort of creative spirit that I had coming out of school, but managed to stretch it out over 7 months and really pace yourself. And, you know, we just started making fun of each other, like, right away, because the script demanded it. And so we'd get on set, and I would just do whatever I could to embarrass him in front of everybody, and he would do the same to me. And that was okay. That was allowed. And we still do it to this day. I was with him until, like, 2 o'clock in the morning last night, shooting a scene on the street. And it's, like, more than ever, you know, we can pretty much say anything. I think whatever we want to do goes, and we trust that that comes from a good place. So yeah. I think that's sort of the secret to my success. Plus, I'm just 1,000 times smarter than him. That helps too. He got all the looks. He got all the looks, but I got all the brains.
For sure. Can you think of the funniest situation on the shooting of Suits? What was the funniest?
Oh, God. Let me think. That's an impossible question. The funniest time on the set of Suits. I mean, it's... You know what? Let me come back to it. I'll think of a story before this is all over, and I'll let you know.
Yeah, okay.
Whatever it is, it's got to involve Rick Hoffman. So I'll have to figure that out.
We have a room full of law students, and I think everybody wants to know, have you ever wished... Whoa.
That would involve that guy.
Yeah, we're all laughing. Yeah, he's such a great actor as well.
That's a good one.
So, returning to the question. So, all lawyers here, future lawyers, I guess, somebody will become.
Congratulations, everybody. Are we all different years in the room, or is this mostly 1 year, or how's it working?
Yeah, different years, from first to sixth.
Who's the closest to being a lawyer in that room right now?
Myself, but...
And who's the farthest away from being a lawyer right now?
The girls.
You guys have to get together with him, he'll help you figure it out.
Have you ever wished to become a lawyer in real life?
Respectfully to what you're all doing, absolutely not. My mom actually really wanted me to be a lawyer. I was an extremely argumentative kid. I was the sort of kid that I would say, I want to go stay at my friend's house this weekend, and I would be told absolutely not. And somehow, within the course of 3 hours, I would have completely argued my way into convincing my parents not only that I should be staying at my friend's house this weekend, but that it was their idea in the first place that I should go. So I'm excellent at manipulating situations and being really, really aggressive with what I want and usually getting it. So my mom definitely thought I should be a lawyer. The only problem is I really didn't love reading that much. More wearing suits, funny enough.
As an actor, you've done theater, you've done movies, you've done TV shows.
So yeah.
What do you prefer the most from this sphere?
You know, theater is, it's hard to compare anything else to theater. Obviously, in terms of like being able to buy things and have like a home, television is a really great gift. It's definitely changed my life in a lot of really positive ways and given me opportunities, but none of those opportunities would be possible were it not for theater. That's where I think an actor really learns how to do what you do. And it's you know, it's the difference for a musician between being in the studio, which would kind of like being in television, which is, you know, you're kind of constantly doing the same thing over and over again and in little pieces, and the difference between playing a live show and being out in front of an audience and playing a whole thing and experiencing what you do with a group of people watching. They're kind of not comparable. When I'm shooting a television show, the thing that I love to do, which is be an actor, I actually only do it for, you know, 3% of my day. The rest of the time is hair and makeup and rehearsal and setting up the cameras and setting up the lights, which is a really interesting and great process, but it's much, much slower. And when I'm in the theater, I go to the theater and I do what I do and what I love to do from the time I walk into the theater to the time I leave. And that's just as an actor. I'm also going to be directing an episode of Suits this year.
Okay, that's great.
And that will be a completely different process, because then I'll be on the set actually doing work the entire time. In fact, it's only the time when other people are acting where I'll be like, come on, let's get it going, I got stuff to direct. So they're all really, really, really different, and they all have completely different shelf lives. And you know, yesterday I sat in my trailer and I watched a couple of episodes from season one just randomly because I hadn't looked at them again. And you know, through the process of doing season one, I was so nervous and anxious, and I was like, this isn't good enough, and I'm not good enough, and nobody's going to like this show, and it's not going to be successful, and everybody's going to think I'm terrible. And now, 4 years later, to be able to sit and watch those episodes with some distance away from it, it's a pretty magical thing to go, wow, we did that. I don't even remember doing that. I can slowly start to understand why we're so lucky and blessed to have people as far away as you guys are right now watching the show.
Okay. Next question. What is your favorite scene from Suits? Apart from the Rachel scene, okay? This is season 2 finale.
When Mike and Harvey got stoned together,
okay.
That was fun. That was really fun. There have been a couple of scenes with Rick. I love working with Rick Hoffman. I think he really is one of the best actors on television. So,
yeah.
You know, it's hard. I can't really even think of like what one scene it is. But anytime we get to really play together, I'm so happy. I think the getting stoned scene was the most fun, because it was, you know, it was so different for our show. It was a real moment where Mike and Harvey like just did not. They just put down their walls and they got to just be two guys hanging out in the room. And then, you know, I loved how that scene really led into that whole discovery through Pearson's background, Hardman, as they were looking for all of the little clues that were going to help them oust Hardman. So I thought that scene was great. There are a couple of scenes where I've been really instrumental in the directing of it, and those have meant a lot too. There are a couple, like the scene where Hardman gets kicked out of the firm. I remember they really let me kind of step up and be involved and come up with some ideas, and that was really rewarding for me. And then a lot of the scenes from the pilot, still, because it was the first episode, still really are important to me. The first interview scene where, you know, I recite the book to him and tell him that I'm going to be the best goddamn lawyer he's ever seen. You know, it's like those scenes were really, that was the scene I auditioned for the show with, and so I did that scene 10-15 times, and then shot the scene, and now, you know, the scene is there for the world to see, and everybody knows that episode, so that has a special place for me as well.
Okay, and is there room for improvisation on the shooting?
Yeah, we get to mess around. It's respectful improvisation, so we always stay pretty close to the script. But we've come to know the writer so well that we can kind of tell, and we hit us, you know, a few lines where they kind of just want us to riff and they're trying to write it and they can't write it because it's just sort of us, again, making fun of each other. So We'll start rolling with it when we find it. But it's always respectful to the writing because all of our writers live in Los Angeles, and we have to make sure that when we're shooting it up here that we don't get it wrong or miss something, because if we miss it once, we don't get it again. And they spend a lot of time writing these scripts. We want to make sure that they get what they want. But that being said, we got a lot of funny people on the show, and when they get it to one place, as long as we get what was in the script once, we usually go and have a few takes where we just screw around.
Yeah, do you have a dream role to play?
There's plenty. Thomas Edison is really fascinating to me. I don't know if you guys ever study him or but I think
he's
really fascinating. A lot of historical characters that I think are totally fascinating. A part that was already played that I wish I could have played was Chris McCandless in a book called Into the Wild. Emil Hirsch did it, Sean Penn directed the film. That part meant a lot to me. There's a book called The Monkey Wrench Gang that has an amazing character in it that I'd love to play. What else is there? Obviously, like to be Batman at some point. I'm a boy, so who wouldn't want to be Batman?
Yeah.
There's tons of parts I want to play. Right now, I'm actually working on a. It's not so much a part, but it's a project that I got excited about. There's a Ukrainian playwright.
Ukrainian.
We sought out, and she's just written a play about those first days in Independence Square in Kiev and during the revolution, and I've been in the process of getting trying to get a translation of that play to do a reading of it here in Toronto, hopefully towards the end of the summer, maybe early fall. And it's a small project. That's something I've gotten really excited about doing, and we're getting close to doing it. So
you have a relation to Ukraine somehow.
Somehow, right.
What are your focus in life? What do you do? A part of that.
Well, let me show you what's. I have like 18 of pretty much within reaching distance of me. Hold on. Hold on.
Yeah, we're here. Okay. I'm not going anywhere.
Alright, so just within 3 feet of my body, when you ask me that, I have this.
Yeah. Okay.
It's a camera, it's a Rolleiflex. So that should be enough camera. But then, of course, I have this camera.
Plenty of
this camera. I have a lot of cameras, so I take a lot of pictures. I spend a lot of time with my dog. Would you guys like to meet my dog?
Yeah.
For sure. What's his name?
It's Charlie.
Okay.
Hold on.
Come here.
Is he gone? Do I lose my dog? Come on.
Yes, no.
Oh, you know what? I think the dog walker took him. She'll be back soon. So maybe you can meet him then. I promise I do actually have a dog.
Okay, we'll believe. What's the Mike Ross recipe for being a top-notch lawyer? Why he's so cool as a lawyer?
I love that you think he's so cool. I think it goes back to your first question. I think Mike, he cares. He cares deeply about the people that he works for. And, I know that that's some tricky territory that you guys probably know way more about than I do as a lawyer, that, there has to be some distance and some dedication to, the fact that everybody deserves a trial, and that there are people sometimes that you work for that probably don't have the strongest moral compass or perhaps might even be guilty. But for Mike, I think he always manages to find the good thing about a person to align with and figures out how to fight for it. And other than that, it's also just his incredible work ethic. It seems like, those first few seasons, I can't tell you how many scenes we're shooting, just him sitting overnight, highlighting, reading, and spending that much time. Now, luckily, he can read a book in like 5 minutes and memorize everything, which I gather would be a pretty useful tool for what you guys are doing. But essentially, really, like, even that stuff has kind of been worked out of the show, because I think really it's just that he works really, really hard, and he cares a lot. And where most people will take a break or take some time off, he's really, if he says that he believes in something, he's going to fight for something, then he fights for it right until the end. And he won't let it go. And along the way, he'll make some mistakes, but even when those happen, they're coming from the right place, and he learns quickly and adjusts and tacks.
Do you mind some questions from the audience?
No, I'd love it.
Okay, so who's that?
How big am I right now? How big am I? How big is the screen?
Yeah, very big, very big. Half of an auditorium. Yeah. A big man. Okay, so who's that? Question right here.
Hello? Can you see
Hello?
Me? I have a couple of questions. Actually, two. What is actually the line between the real legal remedies that you use in USA and those ones that you are showing on the screens? Because recently we had an American teacher that came here, and everyone was asking him, like, did you want to sue? Do you like it? Like, what do you think about it? And he said that he's thinking that half of this is not so true. So I would like to hear about the line between reality and...
Well, I mean, I wish that I could tell you more specifically the reality, but the truth is that, look, it's... I don't know that much about the law. I know that there are some moments where I have researched... You know, when we get a case and I start researching, you know, the constitutional law that's based on, I start reading. I mean, I know so little about it, but I am interested, and obviously to the degree that I can understand what's going on. And look, there are plenty of times when something comes along that is just so far from reality that it's almost bad. I think we might have changed the Constitution of the United States of America at least once or twice on our show. Which is a pretty hard thing to do in real life. It's a show that's based set in law, and we love that law students react so intensely to it. I'm right here. I have an honorary degree from a Dublin Law Society.
Woo!
For playing a great role. of just how, you know, how much people would... Oh, wait a minute. We might have a dog. Wait. I'd be entering. Wait. False alarm. Never mind. It's a law show. It takes place in the law world. But I think what, you know, we've traveled the entire world, and there are people from all different parts of life that are really engaged with the show. And I think that it's... Because while we're talking about law, we're discussing law, really what's going on is we're talking about inner office politics, and we're talking about human beings dealing with each other. Now, using the law as a venue to have that conversation really lets us talk about justice, lets us talk about what's right and wrong, talk about manipulation, talk about strategy. And I think all of those things are very real, and I think that lawyers respond to those because they react to those. But as far as it goes for the like tiny little details of a case, here we go, dog. I'm just on a Skype with about 80 kids in the Ukraine. Say hi.
Woo! Hello.
Thank you so much. All right, hold on, you're gonna be Charlie.
Sir?
Come here. I think that if you pulled the cast, I know more than everybody else, only because they, like, Rick Hoffman just says stuff. He'll admit it to you. He'll just do it. Whatever I say, I'll just say it. I'm the guy that will go and, like, try and learn about it as much as I can in a short period of time. It's not like I'm doing what you guys do. I'm not sitting there with a textbook all night trying to learn it, but I'll try and learn the general sense of what we're talking about. But over the course of the years, the more I look into it, the more I discover sort of how dangerously not real it is. So sometimes I find that it's better that I just pay attention to the intention of the thing rather than really trying to study the legal aspect of it. I have a lot of lawyer friends that say the same thing. They watch the show and they laugh because we don't even have any paperwork. You know, you go to a law office nowadays and it's just stacks of paper and boxes, and you know, everybody in our office is wearing couture dresses that are cut down to here, and we're wearing suits, and as I'm sure you've all been in law offices, you know that it's not quite nearly as sexy as that. But you know, that's television. And I think that we have to, you know, abide by the rules of television to get away with it.
How do you imagine yourself in 10 years, for example?
Whoa, that's scary. Thanks a lot. I imagine myself. I have a lot of hopes. I don't know. I mean, here's the life of an actor. You could all talk about me as that guy that you once saw on a show. You know, right now it's really nice to walk down the street and have people react so strongly, and they love the show, and I've flown around the country. You know, show business is a scary thing, and you know, you play your cards wrong, and I could be, you know, something they're talking about on the 10-year anniversary show of Suits, showing up to, like, Suits conferences. I hope that won't happen. I got a lot of work in the can. I'm definitely going to, you know, traveling around, doing a lot more work. Hopefully we'll start a family at some point in the next 10 years. I don't know what's in store for me. Hopefully a lot more directing. I'd like to be doing that. It's something that means a lot to me. I don't know, traveling a lot more. Hopefully come to the Ukraine. That would be great. Maybe I'll be there in 10 years.
Thank you again for answering everything.
Thank you so much.
Hello. First of all, I have to do this because my brother came to ask me to say hello to you, so hello for my brother.
What's your brother's name?
Farid.
What is it?
Farid.
Farid?
Yes.
Hi, Farid.
Thank you. Well, yeah, and my question is, well, as far as I know, you're Canadian and you work away to say, there are all these stereotypes about American people not liking Canadians, so is it true? And how do you guys get along?
That's a funny question. That's a really good question. I've been in the States now for a little over 10 years, 11 years. I don't think it's so much that people in the States don't like Canadians, they just really love to make fun of Canadians as much as possible. I had an accent, I guess. I didn't know I had it, but when I came to America, I got made fun of a fair amount for my accent, which is, apparently a lot of stories, and let's talk about it. I got made fun of by a lot of the kids I was with, and the accent got kind of pounded out of me. But I think ultimately Americans are just really jealous of Canadians because we have so much space, we're all a lot more chill, we're quiet, we don't have that same... Moving to America is hard. America is like... Have any of you been to America before? Any hands in the air? None? Nobody?
Some of them.
So America's a really intense place, especially in the last 10 years. It's been going through a lot of change, and the sort of corporate world that exists there. It's just everything's being sold to you, and everything's very loud. It's like the rest of the world, the volume just sort of turned up. And Canada's not like that. I don't know if any of you have been to Canada, but Canada's sort of like America light in that sense. You come, we have all the things that you have in America. We just don't need to scream about it at the top of our lungs. So I think a lot of Americans don't like that about Canada. They think that, like, we don't take it seriously. But I get along great with all my American friends. friends now. Now I'm almost entirely friended up with Americans, so.
What would you like more about students, legal part or drama in itself?
It's probably the drama, but it's only the drama that's caused by what we come up with the law stuff. You know, the drama that plays out in everyday human life has been the same since Shakespeare. I mean, we've all, you know, or Chekhov, or, you know, all of these great people, like, they've been telling those stories that we're playing out. And so, really, for us, for me, it's the modern day context of it, which is the law. So I love playing the basic human emotion, like, I'm in love with someone who isn't in love with me, or my best friend is about to hurt me, or I have to turn on somebody I really care about. All that stuff is, you know, what I love to play because it's the actual heart of the thing. But the law stuff, and specifically, you know, the cases that revolve around things that are really going on right now in the world, you know, that stuff's really interesting because I just get to learn about it, and it opens up a new part of my brain that I haven't used before, so you know, I'm fascinated by it, and you know, every time we get a new case or something that, you know, I get to learn about what the SEC is, what the Justice Department does in America, or, you know, how estate law works, or, you know, I like to just have those things come up, and I can sort of study them and understand what they are. I'm sorry, but I still can't believe how popular Suits is in the Ukraine. Is that real, that, like, a lot of you became lawyers because of this show? Is that real? Hold on, I'm going to find a picture on my phone for you. But you can't tell anybody I showed you.
We won't.
Oh, you'll kill me if I show you that photo. Oh, God. You'll kill me. Is this being recorded? Are you going to put this on the internet?
This one, no.
Don't lie. Are you going to?
No.
That's not killing me. Yeah, I would be dead. Gabriel Mattiani.
Okay.
Here's a good one, me and Sarah. We're shooting episode 405 right now. We're shooting episode 405 right now, and there will be 16 episodes. So we're pretty deep into it right now. We're having a lot of fun. Obviously, if you're caught up to the end of season 3, you know, there's a big change with Mike, and I don't want to ruin it for anybody who didn't see it, but Mike had a big change, and so we pick right up there in season 4, and it's made for some really interesting stuff. Mike and Harvey basically get to go head to head on some stuff, so it's been fun playing that, because I feel like Mike is really growing up and sort of coming into his own.
As far as I'm concerned, you're a graduate of University of Southern California,
right? Thank you.
So, it would be very interesting to know whether you enjoyed your student experience. This is first. And maybe you have some piece of advice for students here in this room.
Well, you know, it's a very different thing studying law as it is studying theater. studying theater, you're sort of supposed to kind of really mess around and skip a class and, you know, go see movies and stay up late, like, talking about theater, you know, so my advice is probably not the best advice for law students. Obviously, taking you know, the work seriously was a big part of what I did and what I wanted to do while I was in school. I had the opportunity to do that because so many people don't get the opportunity to do that. But also being in school, it was moments like this right now, and, you know, sitting with like-minded people and talking about, you know, sometimes talking about something that has nothing to do with what you're studying, but just getting a sense of other people's opinions of life and work, and expanding your mind and being open to new ideas was a really big part of my school experience. And, you know, I changed so much in the 4 years that I went to school, because I was surrounded by people who I never would have surrounded myself by. were it not for that time. So I guess doing whatever you can to have an open mind and connect with people around you and have fun. I had maybe too much fun. Remains to be seen, but I think it's a time to really work hard and play hard, and I did both of those.
Thank you very much for your precious time on that session, because
yes,
I know that your schedule is quite crazy. We had quite long negotiations, but I'm very glad we had you today here at our university.
I'm sorry that it took so long to get here, but let's do it again next year or sometime if you're all around. It would be an honor, and I'm so grateful that you guys react to the show the way that you do. It means so much to me and everybody else who I told the whole cast that we were doing this today, and they couldn't believe it, so.
Yeah, I think people are quite happy here. That they can see you, they can talk to you. Yeah, and they really appreciate that you showed up today.
Can we take a selfie together?
Yeah!
You've got to come up to the screen or something.
Smile.
Nice and fair.
Lovely.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you very much.